noite. Sejam todas e todos bem-vindos ao Seminário Internacional Democracia em Colapso, uma realização do SESC São Paulo e da Boitempo, com o apoio da Fundação Rosa Luxemburgo, da Fundação Maurício Grabois e da Claxo, e com promoção da Folha de São Paulo, Revista Marie Claire Brasil, Revista 451, Carta Capital e Rede Brasil Atual. O seminário pretende promover discussões e reflexões sobre as origens e as diferentes perspectivas históricas, políticas e sociais que perpassam o conceito de democracia, a fim de ampliar nossa capacidade de reflexão sobre o assunto e formas de restabelecimento do diálogo democrático. Ao abordar questões conectadas a alguns dos acontecimentos mais marcantes e debatidos da conjuntura atual, o seminário se propõe a fornecer ferramentas e chaves de interpretação para os fenômenos que marcam hoje profundamente a realidade brasileira. O seminário conta com o curso A Democracia Pode Ser Assim, História, Formas e Possibilidades, e com um ciclo de debates, conferências e palestras, com a presença de mediadores e debatedores nacionais e internacionais nos períodos da tarde e da noite. Informamos que, após cada atividade, o público poderá fazer perguntas por meio das fichas inclusas no bloco de notas do seminário. As perguntas deverão ser entregues aos funcionários do SESC, identificados na plateia, e serão repassadas ao mediador. Lembramos que o seminário está sendo gravado em sua íntegra e que os conteúdos serão brevemente disponibilizados online. Sua permanência na sala autoriza o eventual uso de sua imagem. Informamos que, após a realização desta atividade, teremos sessões de autógrafos na área de convivência no térreo e que os títulos da Boitempo estão à venda diariamente no foyer do teatro. No fim dessa mesa, a gente vai ter autógrafos com a Silvia Federici, do livro Mulheres e Caça às Bruxas, e também com a Bianca Santana, do livro Educação contra a Barbárie. E agora, para dar início à palestra Mulheres e Caça às Bruxas, convidamos ao palco Eliane Dias, Bianca Santana e Silvia Federici.
Boa noite a todas, boa noite a todos. Quero agradecer imensamente a presença de todos aqui. É confortante, é fantástico, e no momento que a gente está em tempos tão inóspitos, né, que estejamos juntas e juntos nessa noite. Para quem não me conhece, eu sou Eliane Dias, ativista e empresária no mundo da música, no momento. As minhas maiores pautas são as questões de gênero e raça. Hoje nós estamos aqui com a ilustre presença da Silvia Federici, feminista, ativista, escritora, que está lançando esse livro Mulheres e a caça às Bruxas. Eu já dei uma lida aqui na introdução, achei maravilhoso, e a gente vai aprender muito com ela. Temos também a Bianca Santana, jornalista maravilhosa, ativista, mulher negra que eu adoro. Agora nós vamos ouvir a nossa querida Silvia, em seguida a gente ouve a Bianca.
This working? Yes, it's working. Oof, with all these lights. Good evening. I'm sorry I have to speak English and I'm not speaking in Portuguese. I deeply apologize for it. I hope that the next time I will be able to actually say some words in Portuguese. But I hope you'll forgive me. There is simultaneous translation. Oh, okay. So I want to start by thanking, you know, everybody who has organized this event and have invited me here. I come here tonight after 1 month of traveling, most of it through Brazil. And I have to say that my heart is full of energy, even though I'm exhausted, because of all the women and struggles and stories that I've heard that has shown to me that even though the times are very harsh, nevertheless, people are resisting, people are constructing new forms of life, from the Amazon to the urban spaces, to the schools. There is an ongoing struggle, and networks are being formed that are really now looking forward to creating a different world. And this is, for me, it's enormous, enormous strength. So even though democracy may have collapsed, but you know, actually people are building new forms of democracy. So tonight, the two topics are democracy and witch hunting. And in 40 minutes, I'm going to try to share with you some reflection on both. The first reflection is about democracy and collapse. The question is, if we look at the history of the last 500 years, can we really say that there was a time in the history of this capitalist society in which capitalism was truly democratic? If democracy means self-determination, if democracy means government by the people, for the people, as they say in the United States, and if democracy means that everybody has equal access to the fruits of the earth. If this is democracy, I'm sad to conclude that there's never been, certainly not in the history of modern capitalism, which begins with conquest, colonization, slavery, witch hunting, and in different ways has continued along this path into the present with world wars and today a state of permanent warfare across the world. You know, warfare that is taking many forms, traditional forms as well as microforms, the warfare of the militarization of everyday life, which now is extending to almost every corner of the planet. So I think that we have to understand that when we speak of democracy collapse, when we raise the question, which of course is an important question, it is because this society, this social system, has also been very skillful in creating, on one side, a whole set of hierarchies, forms of unequal forms of life, so that if you look at certain localities or a certain periods of time, or the certain sectors of the populations, then you have the impression that everything is fine. So the ability to actually create, right, hierarchical structures of life, and for example, have people enslaved in one areas of the world and have had a working for the wages, or you know, seeming to have a proper place, some proper reward for the fruit of their work. Like that ability creates a tremendous amount of confusion, because it gives the idea that somehow when we see violence, when we see injustice, that these are abnormalities. That is a perversion of a system that in its essence, right, could provide a good life, el buen vivir, for the people of the earth, right? Now, I come from a perspective that thinks that this is an illusion, that thinks that whatever form of democracy we have experienced in certain times, in certain historical times, or in certain localities, has only been possible because of the tremendous struggle the people have made. It's through the tremendous struggles the people have made, the certain rights have been conquered. So I think this is very important to keep in mind, because it tells us that in a way, it's only by making a tremendous struggle to change this world that we can actually have that process of self-determination that is involved in the concept of democracy. And it seems to me that the situation appears even more clear when we look at it from the point of view of women. Because even when some parts of the male population had access to some form of democracy, for example, the vote, in reality, the majority of women were excluded from it. Or whereas, large number of workers, male workers, particularly white workers, have had access to wage work, right? Women in the great majority have always been those that have worked in situation of unpaid labor, if not labor that came very, very close to being enslaved. And of course, many women have come from a whole history of slavery. So it seems to me that one first principle that we learn of, looking at the history of the past, is that in order to understand what this society is and what are the range of possibilities, we need to look at it from those who have experienced it in its most excruciating form. It's the look from the bottom. I think the look from the bottom that in a way always tells us the truth of the system. Look from the bottom means look from the point of view of those who have known capitalism through conquest, through enslavement, through colonization. And it's not an accident, therefore, that some of the most important struggles and the most revolutionary struggles have taken place, for instance, in a continent like Latin America, that is the place in the world that has the longest holding experience of capitalist society and what capitalism means. And I think that it's important to realize that some of the revolutionary changes in the political perspective that have taken place over the last half a century have been due to the building, to the growing of anti-colonial struggle and the struggle of those who were enslaved. Very clearly, for instance, the change in the conception of what means to make a revolution and what is the content of a struggle has transformed, has changed tremendously as a result of the building of the anti-colonial struggle in the 1960s and the struggle against apartheid, the struggle for civil rights in the United States, the struggle for black power, right? That in a way have opened up a whole new perspective as to how this capitalist society has accumulated its wealth, right? And who are the subject of capitalist accumulation, who are the subject of revolutionary struggle. And this is what I want to talk about it tonight, and in particular with, you know, in relation to, you know, the role of women have had, you know, in the struggles. certainly, the feminist movement, the growth of the feminist movement, for instance, in the United States in the 1970s, was profoundly influenced by the struggle for civil rights. Right? Because the struggle for civil rights in the United States was together with the anti-colonial struggle that built all through the 50s and 60s, actually built through all the 20th century, but culminated in the 60s, right? That struggle, as I was saying before, right, in a sense challenged the traditional leftist view, right, that placed the factory, the industrial working class, you know, at the center of revolution, at the center of capitalist accumulation, as the paradigmatic form of worker and the paradigmatic form of revolutionary subject. That changed in the 60s and in the 70s, and it changed because you had a whole new world of subject coming into the international scene, right? When I say new, it's so to speak, of course, right? Because the struggle of the anti-colonial struggle and the struggle for civil rights in the United States really, you know, opened up a whole new area of exploitation, made visible in a way that could no longer be ignored, made visible in a way that could no longer be ignored, a whole area of work, a whole area of accumulation that had been marginalized by the tradition of the left. Had been marginalized by the tradition of the left. And there is no question in my mind, and not only my mind, right, that that understanding, that opening of a new view had a profound impact also on the women's movement, a profound impact almost on the women's movement. And actually, this was not the first time, it was not the first time that this took place, no? Because the beginning of a women's movement in the United States in 1848, took place after a number of women had participated in London, white women had participated in London in a meeting of abolitionists, in a meeting of people who were fighting against slavery. Right? And they made the connection. They made some connection about their life, their lack of rights, and so forth, and the relation of the slaves. Of course, their position was very, very different, but they made that connection. And something similar also took place in the 1970s, when the civil rights movement was a major spur, right, also to the feminist movement, who basically was also able to see that a whole area of exploitation, a whole area of activities of life, the area of reproduction, right, had been ignored by the traditional left. Right? So I want to make that connection because I think it's very important, it's one example of what I mean by the look from the bottom. How the look from the bottom, in a way, give you a real sense of the totality, right? Clearly what a capitalist system is in all its great complexity cannot be understood unless we look at it from all the point of view, all the different subjects, all the different forms of exploitation. This is true of all systems, but especially of a capitalist system who has made it its business to create difference, to create hierarchy, right? And so we need to see, but those who are at the bottom, in a way, have a privileged perspective. And of course, at the same time, because of a privileged perspective, and because their struggle is so extremely crucially important, because of that are also those who are always the target of the most severe and fierce persecution. And this is the question of witch hunting, past and present, comes in. And tonight I want to speak of a modern form of witch hunting that I think will have a lot of connection with what is happening, you know, here in this country and in this moment, and not only in Brazil. And it's the witch hunting that for many years now has been organized against black women in the United States. And again, I take their situation because in a way it illuminates in a special way what is happening to a lot of women across the world. I was saying before that the civil rights movement was a major turning point in the politics, not only of the US, but I think also of the world. And certainly, black women had a special role in it. They were very much at the forefront of that struggle. And most important, they were also those who extended their struggle in a feminist way. Because one of the consequences and one of the outcomes of the civil rights movement was a struggle that is not well known because it has been so much repressed and yet really needs to be named. It was a struggle of black women in the US on the question of reproduction, and generally referred to as the struggle of welfare mothers. Welfare Mothers was a nationwide organization of women, mostly black women, not because welfare was an especially black women's program. It was not. The majority of the recipients actually were white women. But black women were the women who were fighting most strongly for it. Welfare was a subsidy that since the 1930s, the United States government had given to women who were alone and with children. They didn't have a husband, they didn't have a job because they had very small children. And so in the 1930s, the government, as part of the New Deal, introduced this program. It was intended to benefit mostly white women and widows, women whose husband had died and found themselves alone with small children. This is how the program was understood. But then, in the 1960s, in the wake of the civil rights struggle, right, a lot of black women who were more combative, more organized, began to take on this program and saying, hey, this money that the government is giving to us, as if it were a charity, as if it were a charity, is not a charity. This money is money that is important and that we earn because raising children is work. Raising children is work, right? And right here, there was a profound relation in the 60s and 70s, late 60s, early 70s, between what a lot of the black women in the welfare rights movement, right, were saying and what was happening in the feminist movement. The feminist movement in the same years was discovering reproduction. We were discovering that, hey, all this work, domestic work, raising children, sex work, this is work. This is not just a personal service. No, this is not just something that we do because we are women and, you know, if we have a uterus, that's what we do, we cook. That this, in fact, is work that was organized as much as factory work was organized. In other words, that what we call domestic work was part of the capitalist organization of production, right? The domestic work and the home was a particular type of factory where instead of producing cars or chairs or, you know, carpets, we produced workers, right? This is what we were discovering in the feminist movement in the 70s, in which there were also involved many black women, although at the beginning the majority were white women, right? But the welfare mother struggle was putting that into practice. What the welfare mother struggle did was actually not only come to the same conclusion, but actually building a politics out of that conclusion. They were saying, yeah, when the government needs soldiers, they take our children. When they need people for their factories, they take our children. When they need to build roads, they take our children. But then when we ask for some help to raise these children, then they tell us, oh, it's your problem. It's your individual problem. This is, you know, and so they built the whole struggle. And I have to say with much regret that it was not a struggle that the bulk of the feminist movement supported. I was part of an organization that fought for wages for housework. And we were very inspired. Our organization was actually very, very inspired by the struggle of welfare women. Because we saw that, yes, this is work, and we have a capitalist class, an employer, a world of employers that has made billions, you know, by not having to create the kind of infrastructure that would have been necessary if they had not convinced women to do this work in the communities. Imagine, do a mental experiment, right, of wiping women out, and think about who would go to work on Monday. Who would go to work on Monday, right? So billions have been saved off the backs of women in different places. And we were saying that, and we were saying, well, it's time. Our struggle for wages for housework was a struggle that came from the principle, it's time that we get it back. That we get all that wealth that we too have produced. And we got it back, and we said, and with back pay, retroactive, but that's another story. But the bulk of the women's movement at that time was very much struggling for work outside the home. There was very much the illusion that if we would be able to go and have a job outside the home and also enter the male-dominated workplaces, we would be able to really have much more power, much more autonomy, and so forth. And because of that, unfortunately, the struggle of women on welfare was not supported. And within years, slowly, that money was eroded until 1993, it was completely canceled by Bill Clinton, not a right-wing politician, But it's a presumably a progressive politician, the husband of a presumably feminist politician, right? The husband of Hillary Clinton. He was the one who wiped out welfare, saying, you know, no welfare, workfare. Send these women to work. Meaning, housework is not work. Raising children is not work. So not only that program was slowly eroded, but what began in the early 1970s was a witch hunt, a real witch hunt against black women on welfare, right? All the problems of the economy were blamed on them. They were accused of being parasite on the country. They were accused of creating a whole new generation of young people who had no morals, who had no work ethics, who had no role model because their mother were just parasite and they were living off the work of, you know, the honest workers. So there was a whole media campaign, politician after politician, they started attacking these women as they were criminal. There was a criminalization, and in fact, this is what I'm going talking about, a criminalization of black women for having fought to obtain some support After generation and generation of black people have been enslaved, have been forced to produce billions and billions and billions, in cutting billions and billions of, you know, cotton in the south of the United States, you know, these women were vilified, trashed in the media, you know, and by the politicians, right, for daring to demand some support for the work of raising children. This is something that had a big impact on my life, and not only on my life, but I think of a lot of women that I work with. Certainly, our campaign was very much influenced by it, and we did support their struggle, and we were very critical of the feminist movement for not being coming out as strongly as they should have, right, to support their struggle and recognizing that what black women on welfare were fighting for was in our interest, was for the interest of all of us, because they were saying that, yeah, this is work. This work is work. It's not a personal service. It's not women's labor. Is not something that is just natural, right? But it's something that, in fact, it's beneficial to hold the power structure. And at the same time, we are being forced to, you know, live. Oh, okay. Ooh. All right. That's a shock. Oh, then in 5 minutes, I will conclude. And this is the beginning of a witch hunt, because that witch hunt is not as continued. And not accidentally, black women have been, you know, one of the targets of you know, the campaign the politicians have made, you know, all through these years. And, you know, they have been, their situation in relation to work and in relation to their community, right, has been taken as an example of the fact that where there's not a mother, where the mother is not engaged in all kinds of outside work activities, right? The community cannot flourish. At the same time, black women have had a profound impact on the women's movement, not only through the struggle on welfare, but also in relation to the struggle for abortion. And I will use my last 5 minutes to make a point that I think is very, very important now, since the struggle for abortion is so crucial still here in Brazil, is crucial in the United States, is crucial in Argentina. The struggle for the right to abortion was central for feminism in the US and Europe, you know, through the 70s, until in many places it was legalized. But what the same black women have fought for welfare told us, reminded us, was that the right to abort, it's only part of control over our bodies. It's only a part of the control over our bodies. In order to really be able to decide about our bodies and our lives, we also have to be the right to be mothers. And they spoke from a profound knowledge, since from the time of slavery, most black women have not been able to really have the right to be mothers. As you know, in slavery, they could be mothers only of children who'd be put on auction. And many times in the US, for example, in Virginia, in West Virginia, right, they were forced to be part of a breeding industry, which means they were systematically raped and forced to procreate because they found, the slave owner found it was cheaper to have slaves produced in the plantation than to import them from Africa, particularly after the slave trade was made illegal by England in the early 19th centuries. So there was a breeding industry, and that attack on black women's capacity to be mother continued through the 40s and 50s with many forms of sterilization. Many women who were receiving welfare were sterilized. And that sterilization has continued into the jails, into recent time. In 1970s, for example, in California, women were still, black women were still being sterilized. So a movement in the 1990s began of black women which said the right to abortion is only part, and they created a movement called the Movement for Reproductive Justice. Reproductive justice means control of our body cannot be separated, cannot be earned only through the right to abort. It has to be connected with a whole struggle around economic issue to change the material conditions of our life. It has to be connected to a whole struggle to change the material condition, because if we donate the material condition to also raise children, then we cannot speak of having a control of our life. And I think that that issue is still very crucial today. And to conclude, because it seems to me that I'm coming to the end, but we'll have more time to have a discussion, I think that that lesson is extremely important today. And of course, not accidentally, you know, we have an attack on black women in the US today, as we have had an attack on women throughout the once colonial world, you know, since the 90s. I'm referring here, for instance, to the struggle for population, the World Bank struggle for population control, right? I wouldn't call it struggle, but campaign for population control, right? Because in response to the anti-colonial struggle, they discovered that women in the colonies, in the former colonies, were creating, bringing to the life, bringing to the world too many children, and try to justify the poverty of places like Africa or Latin America or parts of Asia With the argument that this was women who were making their community poor by having so many children. So all this population control was clearly a response to the anti-colonial struggle, to the fact that you have a whole generation of young people who were coming into the world, who wanted the wealth that had been taken away from the European, they wanted it back. And so they discovered population control. All of a sudden, they were not happy. The women were producing so many children and they have so many workers, which usually they'll be very happy of. More children, more workers means cheaper wages, more exploitation. But then, not if they work, those workers rebel. If those workers are asking the wealth back, if they're organizing as they did in the anti-colonial struggle, then you have to sterilize them. Then there is population explosion. Then you discover that these women were producing too many children. Something like that is happening today in the United States as well. And we have a process. In fact, the group that I work with in New York is working around that. A process that has been called, not by us, the criminalization of pregnancy of black women, the criminalization of pregnancy, which means that, as a woman put it, a national healthcare worker, her name is Lynn Paltrow, as she put it, today, if you are a black woman and a poor black woman, or immigrant woman, or a Latina woman, and you decide to have a child, and you get pregnant, you literally put yourself outside of the Constitution, meaning you become vulnerable to all kinds of accusation that would never be imaginable for any other person. For instance, women have been arrested after they were in a car accident and they told the police that they were pregnant, and they were arrested. They were arrested because they were told that they are putting the fetus at risk. They are putting their fetus at risk. Women have been arrested for taking medicine, legal medicine, that affected the child in their womb. And to give an example, I don't have the time now, but to give an example, a black woman during a fight, this happened a month ago, right, was hurt. She was knifed by another woman, and she was arrested. The woman who was hurt was arrested because the accusation was starting a fight while pregnant. Starting a fight while pregnant. So this is what we are talking about witch hunting. There is now, in many parts of the world, there are now real witch hunts. In other words, women are still accused of being witches. But there's other witch hunts that we have to see. And there are other witch hunts that are being carried out, particularly against women, right, who do not have been impoverished. I'm not saying poor, they've been impoverished. The concept of the poor naturalizes poverty. You have to ask why people are poor. They've been made poor. And women who are in a position of knowing a lot about exploitation and fighting against it. And we have to support their struggle, because their struggle is also our struggle. Thank you very much.
Bem, a gente vê, dia a dia, acaba a gente vendo e entendendo e compreendendo e aceitando o quanto a escravidão foi violenta para nós, mulheres negras, o quanto o capitalismo ele é violento para as mulheres. E talvez seja por isso que nós, feministas, tentamos conscientizar todas as mulheres que juntas somos mais fortes. Essa questão da prisão das mulheres grávidas, ou de criminalizar mulheres grávidas, ou de acusar mulheres grávidas, seja lá pelo que for, é uma coisa muito séria, é uma coisa que a gente vem falando de forma lúdica entre nós, negras, que talvez pegassem os nossos filhos nos nossos ventres. A gente vem falando disso já há algum tempo, porque a cada 2 horas um jovem negro é assassinado no Brasil, e as mulheres negras continuam sofrendo. Então, pensar que daqui, que a gente, do momento que a gente chegou aqui até o momento que a gente vai sair daqui, 2 mulheres estão chorando por seus jovens negros assassinados, é uma coisa terrível e que só juntas conseguiremos vencer. E com muito trabalho e muito difícil, muito complicado. Para eu passar a voz para a Bianca, a palavra para a Bianca, eu tenho que colocar aqui uma reflexão do encarceramento em massa dos negros. Encarceramento em massa, não só no Brasil, mas também fora do Brasil, em outros países, que se dá com uma violência muito maior, com a privatização das penitenciárias. É muito conveniente que se privatize as penitenciárias e coloquem uma nova forma de escravidão para funcionar. Coloquem o povo para trabalhar encarcerado, de graça, sem pagar para fazer um sapato, sem ter que pagar imposto para fazer uma mesa, sem ter que pagar um imposto para costurar uma roupa, sem ter que pagar em salário. Então, é uma reflexão muito ampla, bem grande. E também a questão de que eu penso de forma bem distante, essa questão de diminuir a população negra, seja de que forma for. Bem recentemente, muito recente, eu soube de alguns hospitais aqui em São Paulo que esterilizavam mulheres. Tive contato com algumas delas, então uma coisa realmente é bem complicada. Então, juntas, somos mais fortes, principalmente para falar sobre essa questão da previdência, que, de novo, está na base, com as mulheres negras que serão as mais prejudicadas e que, assim como nos Estados Unidos, terão que sair para a rua para discutir essa questão da previdência. Incrível isso, né? O tempo passa e a gente tem que continuar com as mesmas lutas, né? Hoje não é dia da minha fala. Vamos lá, meu amor, vai lá.
Também poderia te ouvir bastante. Eu até me sinto mais confortável na figura de mediadora, então a gente pode trocar rapidamente. Boa noite. É bastante tentador para mim começar com uma pergunta de quem aqui faz o próprio trabalho de reprodução da vida, quem aqui lava a própria privada. Mas eu não vou fazer vocês passarem por esse constrangimento. Deixo vocês pensarem sobre isso depois de ouvir a Silvia. E começo agradecendo o convite por estar aqui com essas 2 mulheres também que eu tanto admiro, que eu já tive a honra de entrevistar para a revista Cult, e poder falar sobre temas que não são tão caros. Tive a honra de escrever o prefácio desse novo livro da Silvia, e compartilho aqui com vocês algumas das coisas que estão escritas ali naquele prefácio. Bom, a pergunta da Silvia, de quando tivemos democracia plena, é uma pergunta excelente, que, quando a gente olha para esse dado apresentado também pela Eliane agora, de a cada 23 minutos um jovem negro ser assassinado no Brasil, e esses não são dados do atual governo, Esses são dados dos governos que nós defendemos. Isso é gravíssimo. No governo, nesses governos que nós defendemos, o número de mulheres brancas assassinadas caiu 9,8%, enquanto o feminicídio entre as mulheres negras cresceu 54%. Esses dados vão até 2013. O encarceramento explodiu de homens e de mulheres nesse período. Então, por mais que a gente faça acusações a este governo, e ele merece, e uma família de milicianos não pode ocupar a presidência da República desse país, não pode? E que a população indígena do Equador nos ensine a insurgência, porque estamos, de fato, precisando. Família que tem ligação direta com o assassinato de Marielle Franco. Ainda assim, nos governos que defendemos, a democracia não era plena. A Silvia é das poucas autoras brancas que eu conheço que vê centralidade na pauta racial. E aqui eu te agradeço especialmente por isso, Silvia. É uma lição para todas e todos nós e para a esquerda branca brasileira que ainda não entendeu a centralidade dessa luta. E nas atuais formas de cercamento e de caças bruxas, a gente precisa olhar para o racismo religioso que tem destruído terreiros por todo o Brasil, especialmente na Baixada Fluminense, que tem perseguido e usado violência física contra pessoas que usam branco, contra quem está com as suas guias. Essa é uma forma muito perversa de perseguição que tem aumentado. Agora, né, que a Eliane falou de casos que ela ouviu de mulheres que são esterilizadas ainda hoje no Brasil, eu tive, infelizmente, uma notícia recente de uma amiga, mulher negra, de classe média alta, que foi esterilizada num hospital da rede particular de São Paulo. Isso acontece hoje, em 2019, com ela aconteceu em 2018, na rede pública e na rede particular também. De mulheres negras que vão tirar um mioma uterino porque querem engravidar e que saem do centro cirúrgico sem o seu útero. Então, fica a minha solidariedade imensa a essa amiga e precisamos, de fato, prestar atenção também nisso. Eu tenho pouquíssimo tempo, então vou precisar da ajuda de vocês. Muitos dos nomes que eu vou citar aqui eu não vou ter tempo de aprofundar, mas eu espero que vocês busquem depois. Porque, se a gente tem muitas formas de cercamento, nós também temos muita resistência. E eu gostaria de mencionar algumas. A começar pelo Instituto Marielle Franco, em que Aniele Franco, irmã de Marielle, tem feito uma batalha importantíssima, não só para, de fato, descobrir quem mandou matar Marielle, mas também de construção do legado político que Marielle iniciou. Vocês também já devem conhecer a luta que Áurea Carolina e Talíria Petroni estão travando no Congresso Nacional. Essas mulheres têm conseguido barrar retrocessos imensos e propor, de fato, direitos e leis que nos são importantes. Mas eu gostaria de mencionar, em especial, algo que elas têm feito, e que vocês podem procurar, sobre a consulta à população quilombola em relação à base de Alcântara. Elas criaram um site chamado Consulta Quilombola Já. Se vocês procurarem, vocês vão saber mais sobre o que tem acontecido no Maranhão. Infelizmente, naquele congresso terrível, né, na Câmara Federal, eles conseguiram aprovar com urgência a votação de um tratado entre o Brasil e os Estados Unidos, que o Eduardo Bolsonaro articulou com os americanos, em troco de nada, não é? Como todo mundo aqui já sabe, para entregar aquele território para a construção de uma base que tanto afeta a soberania nacional como afeta a vida de 800 famílias que vivem naquele território. O Brasil é signatário de um acordo internacional de que, quando isso acontece, as populações tradicionais precisam ser consultadas. Isso não ocorreu. Com base nisso, a Áurea Carolina conseguiu, apesar da aprovação de urgência, barrar a votação imediata. E ela conseguiu que o presidente da casa, que agora, né, é um grande aliado, são tempos complexos esses, mas é verdade, ela conseguiu a garantia dele de que o projeto não tramitaria antes de um relatório do Ministério Público Federal, que, de fato, disse que as comunidades precisam ser consultadas. Então, essas mulheres negras, duas, com, obviamente, apoio de aliadas e aliados negros e brancos, mas elas estão conseguindo, na unha, barrar retrocessos. Menciono também sobre Alcântara a Neta Cerejo, que é uma mulher quilombola de Alcântara, e a Selma de Aldina, que é da Coordenação Nacional da CONAC, de Comunidades Quilombolas, que são mulheres que, em seus territórios, têm travado essa importante luta. Hoje, na CONAC, há muitas mulheres quilombolas ameaçadas. Eu cito uma, Sandra Braga, do Quilombo Mesquita, perto de Brasília. O quilombo está cercado de fazendas de pessoas poderosas, incluindo a família Sarney. Cavaram uma cova no quintal da família da Sandra, dizendo que era para esperar o corpo dela. O pai da Sandra morreu do coração recentemente, depois de a filha dele ser ameaçada uma outra vez. E esse é um cenário comum em todo o Brasil, especialmente na população rural. Pacote Moro. Vocês estão acompanhando? Acompanhem, de verdade. Porque na Coalizão Negra por Direitos, e esse é outro nome que eu gostaria que vocês buscassem, a gente tem travado uma batalha diária junto com parlamentares aliados, é que alguns deles às vezes não são muito aí, né? Falha, desculpa. Sem querer. Mas tem parlamentares aliados e aliadas, e acho que vale também mencionar o Orlando Silva, um parlamentar negro aqui de São Paulo, que também tem feito um trabalho muito importante, de conseguir, num grupo de trabalho, barrar absurdos como ampliação de excludente de licitude para policial que atirar e alegar forte emoção. Outra coisa que foi barrada no grupo de trabalho é uma ampliação indiscriminada do banco genético de pessoas presas. Naquela proposta do Sérgio Moro, qualquer pessoa que passar pelo sistema carcerário vai ter a sua amostra de DNA coletada. O que significa calcular, segundo a Maria José Menezes, que é da Marcha das Mulheres Negras de São Paulo e pesquisadora da USP, que eles vão ter pelo menos 2% dos dados de DNA de toda a população, o que é muita coisa, e que não tem nenhuma justificativa científica ou para a segurança pública desses dados serem coletados e armazenados. Isso é a serviço do mercado. Vocês devem saber hoje que, quando a gente faz compras numa farmácia usando o nosso CPF, esse banco de dados é utilizado por muitas instituições. Tem uma pesquisa da Joyce, esqueci o nome dela, desculpa, mas vocês vão procurar. Ela fez um mestrado na Federal do ABC sobre privacidade e uso de dados, e ela viu que hoje a indústria farmacêutica repassa os dados de mulheres que compram anticoncepcional para bancos de RH. Então, quando uma mulher para de comprar anticoncepcional, a empresa dela vê. E aí ela decide se essa mulher vai ser demitida imediatamente ou se eles podem ficar com ela um pouco mais de tempo. Isso não é teoria da conspiração, isso está acontecendo hoje. Vocês podem imaginar o que acontece, o que aconteceria com a coleta indiscriminada dos dados de pessoas presas? Num país com um histórico racista e eugenista como o Brasil? Pois bem, barramos no grupo de trabalho, mas amanhã tem a proposta de votação no Senado Federal dessa mesma matéria, na Comissão de Constituição e Justiça. Então, deve ter um tuitaço amanhã, eu não estou sabendo bem, porque eu passei o dia aqui, mas vai ter, com certeza, algo, e, por favor, procurem, porque a gente precisa barrar isso agora, não tem depois. Por isso a Silvia está tão cansada, por isso a Eliane trabalha tantas horas. Não tem depois. A gente precisa mesmo trabalhar muitas horas, porque nós somos a resistência. Mais alguns nomes de mulheres que têm travado essa luta lá na Coalizão Negra por Direitos. A Maria Silvia, Sheila, Mariana Belmonte, que está aqui. a Deise Benedito, que é uma mulher que, em 92, acompanhou a CPI do massacre do Carandiru e que, ininterruptamente, tem dedicado a sua vida na luta contra o encarceramento e pelo direito das pessoas presas. A Sueli Carneiro, além de fundadora de Guilherme, também muito presente nessa tentativa do movimento negro de ação conjunta no Congresso Nacional e de incidência internacional. A Cida Bento, Regina Dami, Vilma Reis, que vai ser prefeita de Salvador, não sei se vocês já sabem. A Natália, Vânia Santana, Nilma Bentes, do Pará, que trouxe a ideia do bem viver para a Marcha das Mulheres Negras no Brasil. A Leila, Winnie, e eu poderia aqui passar a noite citando nomes dessas mulheres que são resistência para vocês. Bom, se temos cercamentos, e o meu tempo acabou, vale lembrar também que hoje é dia das professoras e dos professores que travam uma luta, e parabéns para vocês que estão aqui. E que estão no fronte, porque hoje o ensino crítico na sala de aula também tem sido criminalizado. Então, essas mulheres e esses homens têm travado uma batalha que merece o nosso apoio. As companheiras do Ilu Obademin, que com os nossos tambores enchemos as ruas dessa cidade de resistência. Aos livros e publicações de tantas mulheres negras, de tantas mulheres. Ao movimento de moradia, e Preta Ferreira não está mais na cadeia. Babi Querino, que também foi presa porque a roubaram um carro, e, segundo a mulher branca que foi roubada, a mulher que assaltou tinha um cabelo black power. Isso foi suficiente para que a preta, para que a Babi Querino fosse acusada e condenada. Depois de passar 90 dias na cadeia, ela também pôde sair. 90 dias foi a preta, a Babi foi mais de um ano, me desculpem. Marcha Mundial das Mulheres, Marcha das Mulheres Negras, tantos e tantos movimentos Brasil afora. Nós estamos despertas, estamos em movimento e não passarão.
É isso. Muito bom saber que estamos, que somos muitas, né? São tantos dados que eu coloquei. A cada 2 horas, uma mulher é assassinada, né? A cada 23 minutos, um jovem negro é assassinado. Desculpa, é tanto crime que, às vezes, né, a cabeça vai fazer um revés. Eu tenho aqui 12 perguntas para a Silvia, todas são para ela, claro. Eu vou passar 4 perguntas para você, Bianca, para você fazer em inglês. E, porque meu inglês é péssimo, mas vou pura birra, militância. Oh, militância às vezes prejudica a gente, né? E depois eu faço as outras, tá bom?
Vai ser puxado isso aí para mim também, mas vamos lá. Mas aí eu vou...
Está escrito em inglês, ela não entendeu.
Não, mas então, eu não sei o que é pior, se é pior eu traduzir ou ler inglês, mas tudo bem. Querida Silvia, obrigada pela sua existência e por seu pensamento brilhante. Eu gostaria de saber o que você pensa sobre o direito ao aborto no Brasil. Porque a gente... isso ainda não caminhou, porque a gente não luta suficientemente... ou porque o número de mulheres que está nessa luta é muito pequeno? Obrigada. Essa pergunta foi feita pela Dora. Dora, eu tentei. Tem outra pergunta da Vanessa Pedro. Agora que nós temos visto o movimento feminista se fortalecer e muitas mulheres jovens chegando à luta, nós também podemos ser vistas como um momento de colapso? É, não tem essas dificuldades, tem esse momento de dificuldades e de conservadorismo, mas, no geral, todo mundo, direita e esquerda, vê uma sociedade em colapso. Talvez a gente só possa ver essa escuridão na Idade Média, e a gente não vê o outro lado. É justo com as mulheres e com a nossa luta pela democracia? Guilherme, falando de artes e do impacto das artes nessa sociedade, você, nessa sociedade, né, de produção, você acredita que a literatura possa fazer alguma coisa para ajudar a melhorar a experiência de resistência a essa sociedade? E, da Gabriela, a última pergunta. Hoje é dia dos professores no Brasil. Ensinar crianças é vista como uma carreira feminina. E a gente vive hoje no Brasil uma paranoia de que as professoras estariam doutrinando as crianças. Essas duas coisas podem estar relacionadas? Da perseguição aos professores, e professores, né, ser uma carreira feminina, e de essa paranoia de estarmos doutrinando crianças?
Obrigada. Eu vou, meu amor, eu vou seguir aqui, que são só 8, e aí já respondi tudo de uma vez. Melhor responder antes? Tudo bem? Perguntar tudo? Ok. Eu tirei.
Ela vai perguntar, ela pode responder essa primeiro?
Sim, porque ela vai olvidar. Sim.
How many do you have? How many do you have? Mais 4 ou mais 8?
8.
8.
8. Ok. Let me try to see this one.
You have water there?
I am not sure why the struggle for abortion in Brazil it's small. Why few women are struggling for the right to abortion? Because it seems to me, I know that this is not true in the United States and in many parts of the world. In Argentina, it's a big struggle. So perhaps here, the religious right is stronger. So I really don't know how to answer this. I think you can answer this question better than me, because it seems to me that both from the point of view of being able to care for children and from the point of view of also the consequences. I don't know, again, there's many things I don't know. In the United States, having a child is very expensive. Even in the cheapest ways, is very expensive. So that I know that a lot of women, for example, don't want to go through the cost. Secondly, having children and having to work right away out of the home, it's also really very, very difficult, right? One answer that I propose, or two answers, one certainly is the question of the impact of religion, perhaps, I know there's been a huge investment, by the Vatican and by Protestant churches to attack women, to wage a war on women who are having abortion. So this is one possibility. For instance, there's been a lot of financing in the United States of the Right to Life movement. The Right to Life movement. These people, they go to clinics where women are having abortion, and in great numbers, and for all the time they scream, you know, assassin, assassin, assassin. So they intimidate. So there's a whole process of intimidation. It's a great hypocrisy, and it has to be denounced as hypocrisy, as a big lie. The right to life, the defense of life, lasts only until the fetus is in the womb. The moment the fetus becomes a child, the moment the child is born, they do not give one penny, $1, one reales for the child. They don't care if that child, when he's born, lives or dies. But they will persecute the woman, calling her a murderer. So perhaps this is one reason. Another reason, perhaps, is that for many people who have been deprived of everything, sometimes having a child is one of the few joys that is left. So much is taken away from people. They're having your own child, your own family, your own relation. It gives a meaning to life. You know, once you've been, you know, stripped of so many things. So these are my two possible answers. So about the movement being collapsing, I don't see that. I've been traveling in Brazil. I was in Bahia. I was also in San Luis, Maranhão. I've been in Sao Paulo now for quite a bit. And all I see is a lot of struggle. In Bahia, I was in a meeting, 2 days of meeting with women from all over Brazil. Indigenous women, women from the MST, women from all kinds of grassroots organizations. Each of them was a whole history of struggle. Women are building support network. Women are fighting for defending their community. They are fighting for defending their land. They are fighting for defending their forest. They are struggling against mines. There was a whole issue of struggle. I don't see a movement that is collapsing. I see a really powerful movement growing. And teachers, you know, there is now a war, you know, on the schools. There is a war on teachers, and many of the women, of the teachers are women. There is a war, and it's not only in Brazil. You know, for instance, I know about Italy, there is a war on changing the history books, even at the elementary school, right? Changing history, because they want to rewrite history, right? They want to rewrite history, because history is dangerous. If you know, if it comes close to the truth. And so the schools, always, it's always been important to capture children when they're young, right? And that's why teaching is such an important job. And often, you know, women have done teaching because it's almost a continuation of child raising. But, and often teaching has been devalued because it's been done by women. But it's actually very, very crucial. It's raising the new generation. It's creating, it's part of the creation of a new world. This is it.
Vamos lá. Amanda Mendonça. Ela pergunta,
No capitalismo, tudo se mercantiliza. Vende-se tudo como mercadoria, sexo e atividades intelectuais. Na sociedade que queremos construir, sexo também poderá ser mercantilizado? A controvérsia. A Beatriz pergunta, em uma perspectiva de trabalho doméstico não remunerado, como você enxerga a heterossexualidade e a monogamia no que diz respeito ao controle dos corpos femininos? Como vocês veem a violência doméstica e o feminicídio no Brasil? Eu fico tentada a responder e não posso, entendeu? Então, meio que me controlo, né? A Amanda, como você compreende a questão das mulheres transexuais no contexto da organização do trabalho reprodutivo? Agora, vou... Ok.
Ok.
Só faltam...
Four?
Four more? Ok. But anyway, they're very quick question, because how do I see sex in... No, I don't see a society, you know, the society I want to build is not a society that will be built on buying and selling, you know, human bodies, buying and selling human labor. At the same time, as you probably, some of you probably know, I'm also against the kind of demonization that some feminists carry on about sex work. So, you know, women have been selling their bodies in all kinds of ways, selling your labor, selling your bodies, and you sell your bodies in marriage, for instance. You marry for security, right? So, and you sell, you know, your sexual work on a second job, working outside the home to keep a job, not to be laid off, or to gain a promotion. You know, so many times women have had less access to resources than men, less access, you know, that to property, to wages, to work, not to work, but to remuneration than men, so that selling one sexual service has been one way for women to survive. It is a class issue. It is a class issue. It's also not seen that many, many jobs today are not better option for women. And feminists should not be in the business of telling women which kind of exploitation we want, which kind of exploitation is okay, and which kind of exploitation is not okay. You know, I think our struggle should be to make it possible for everybody not to have to sell themselves. And that is true. Yeah. Heterosexuality and monogamy, first of all, monogamy has only been true for women, because men never had monogamy. So, you know, the sense, and heterosexuality and monogamy and the whole organization of the nuclear family is obviously being organized, you know, as to be functional to the labor market and functional to the reproduction of the workforce. So this is my answer. I think it's been very much the condition, you know, the condition of reproduction that has been instituted by the capitalist class. So that too, you know, it's been very much at the center of the challenging of a feminist movement, And you know, this connects with the struggle, the question about transsexuality, right? So that heterosexuality and the compulsion to sexual identification, the compulsion to sexual identification, the fact that you have to be either man or woman. And for example, a lot of people who are intersex, who don't have a clear definition, you know, biological definition, have been tortured by doctor, by surgeon. They've been literally tortured to fit into one of the two molds, right? This is all part of a particular organization of reproduction that has been constructed with certain economic objectives. And there is today, I imagine there is also in Brazil, right, an intersex movement, right? An intersex movement who is refusing, for instance, you know, to have children, you know, to be subjected to surgery as soon as they are born, you know, so that they can be women, they can be men, so that you can chop one part or chop another part of their bodies, you know, and make them fit into the norm, right? So I imagine there is an intersex movement, you know, here too. The domestic violence and feminicide in Brazil. I mean, I think you can answer that question better than me, right? Because I can tell you about feminicide and domestic violence in Europe, in the United States in particular, right? I think about the situation of Brazil is something that is more familiar to you. No, domestic violence, I can say, is a structure, an element, a structural element of the organization of the nuclear family. No, domestic violence, again, is not just the problem of a few violent men or many violent men. It's really an element of the organization of family life. And I want to explain what I mean. You know, the way the family has been constructed is that you have a man, usually he's the one who brings the money in, he's the one who is recognized as a worker, and traditionally you have a woman who is a wife who is dependent, right? She's the one who is supposed to service him, she's the servant, and she's dependent on him for her survival. He has the power, he's socially recognized, she's not. And so the violence is part of that setup, because in a way, through the wage, through money, the state, capital, gives men the power to discipline women. So it's the father, it's the husband who disciplines the women in the house. He can say, don't go out. He can say, you don't do this, you do this, you do that. Until recently, for instance, a husband could impose, force the wife to have sex in the family, whether she didn't want it or not. Didn't matter. She couldn't go to the state, to the police, and say, oh, my husband raped me, right? Because it was understood that through marriage, he gained the power to obtain her services. He supports her economically, so he has the right to come home, to have food, the house should be clean, she should be ready to make sex, etc., etc. So the violence often has to do with disciplining her work, disciplining the woman. The house is not clean, the food is not ready, the children are screaming, and so she doesn't want to make love, right? So these are the classical example, the classical situation of domestic violence, which means that domestic violence has always been tolerated by the state because it is recognized that this is part of the organization of domestic work, right? That he has the right to certain services and can use violence in the same way as parents are allowed to beat up their children. Parents are allowed to beat up their children. And we have to make that a feminist issue. We have to say no, not only to violence against us, we have to say no to violence against children. Yeah. Thank you, because I don't think the feminist movement has made the question of violence against children strong enough, central enough. And this is really a problem, because the effects of that violence, of parental violence, that presumably is a sign, oh, I care for you. Yeah? You know, have you heard the story? Oh, he beat her up because he loved her so much, right? And parents, they're beating up children because they care so much about them, they're worried about what happens to them, you know? In reality, is that this kind of violence is not considered violence, because it is recognized there is a violence that is functional. Functional, for example, to the creation of future workers. The child is a worker in training, and so, you know, the state delegates to the family, to the parents, the right to beat up a child. And no parents goes to jail unless you kill the child. Right, okay, you're not supposed to kill the child. Actually, you know, slave owners were not supposed to kill slaves either, right? So that's a very important issue that we have to take. And feminicide today takes many, many forms and new forms, because it takes place not only in the family, but now we have a lot of violence against women. And it's a violence that has to do with the struggles that women are making. I was saying before that there's a lot of struggle women are making to defend their community, right? To defend them, for example, against the coming of a mine, the coming of a petroleum company who is going to destroy the land, is going to destroy the waters, who is going to destroy the well-being of the community. So this is why the many women are being attacked by paramilitary, narco-traffickers. Women are defending their community in the urban centers, in terms of housing, in terms of providing some forms of support or some forms of subsistence. And women are fighting to not be subjected to, you know, be socially subordinate, to have autonomy. And that's why they are becoming more and more, you know, the target of many men. But I want to make a point about violence and about feminicide. I've come to the conclusion that all violence is institutional, because also the reason why many individual men can afford to kill a woman is because they feel that they have impunity. They feel they can get away with it. And also important to see that violence is not only something physical, not something that is done with a gun or with a knife. You know, violence is also economical. You know, any legislation, any economic practice that leads to starving people, that leads to dispossession, to displacement, that's violence. That is violence. So we need to see the economic practices are also part of that violence, and not only associate violence only with physical assault on a person, no? And I think that this is a very important when we struggle in terms of against feminicide, because we also need to look at the legislation. For example, denying the abortion, the right to abortion to women is a form of violence.
Bem, nós temos 4 perguntas aqui e temos 25 minutos para respondê-las. Tudo bem, meu amor?
Ok.
É. Então, vamos lá. É, a Annalise, ela perguntou como a senhora chegou nessa tese de caça às bruxas na era contemporânea.
Difícil
Agora que, como ambas convidadas enxergam a captura dos desejos das lutas populares, principalmente por mulheres, pelo sistema capitalista? Bem, eu entendo como o sistema, como a gente entende o capitalismo capturando nossas lutas, é isso. Aqui no Brasil está em curso uma campanha pró-adoção, modificando o Estatuto da Criança e do Adolescente, a fim de facilitar e acelerando a destituição do pátrio poder, com a justificativa de proteger as crianças. Como se entende isso? Em Caliban e a Bruxa, você fala da solidariedade entre as pessoas. Eu acho que é no campo, não entendi muito bem, no campo. Não podemos retornar a esse lugar aboliço da propriedade privada. Como então fazer um furo nesse sistema e fomentar essa solidariedade? Essa eu não entendi, desculpa. Você entendeu, Bianca? Entendi. Quer ler? Entendeu?
Posso tentar, então?
Pode. Quer ler?
Não, no Caliban e a Bruxa,
sim,
que a Silvia fala da... Vamos lá. Aqui, ó. Em Caliban e a Bruxa, você fala da solidariedade entre as pessoas do campo comum, do campo comunal, imagino. Não podemos retornar a este lugar.
From the?
The common.
Uh-huh. Okay.
A gente não pode abolir a propriedade privada. Como, então, fazer furo nesse sistema e fomentar essa solidariedade?
Calma, acabou.
This witch hunting today is not a thesis. I mean, they're killing women, accusing them of being witches today. Thousands of women are being killed in Africa, in India, accusing them of being witches. In the book, if you buy the book, the Boy Tempo has just published, the last section is a whole article on witch hunting that is taking place now, right now. And it's calculated that thousands and thousands of women have been killed and often brutally tortured before being killed, accused of being witches. And the article in the book makes the connection between this resurgence of witch hunting and the new forms of capitalist accumulation. And the attack on communal lands and the process of impoverishment and the displacement of entire population. So I'm making a connection between the witch hunting, the use, and also make the connection with the spread across the world of many Protestant sects that are using in their rhetoric, the idea of the devil, of conspiracy by the devil, and sin, et cetera, et cetera. And, these religious sects, Pentecostal, evangelical, have had a major, major impact in many parts of the world in the last 3-4 decades in bringing back the whole issue of the devil. And and they've gone to population, to areas of the world where people were under a terrible stress because they were being expropriated, they were being impoverished by the International Monetary Fund, austerity policies, and so on. And they've gone on saying, oh, well, if you're poor, it's not because of the International Monetary Fund, but it's because there are people in your community who are conspiring against you, right? So we have to look into that. And but I'll say, look at that article, and I think you'll find a much better answer than I can give you in a few minutes. But witch hunting is taking place. For instance, women also in Latin America who are dealing with herbs, who are trying to recuperate, you know, old knowledges about the property of plants and herbs, are now being accused of being witches, you know, curanderas and so on. They are now being accused of using powers that are not, you know, good powers. The campaign for adoption, I don't know, I don't know exactly the law here, but all I can say is that, you know, in many parts, everywhere, you know, women are losing rights with respect to children. More and more rights are being given to the fathers and less, you know, to women. And the whole issue of adoption is a real serious problem because, you know, it's poor people once again being taken away, having seen their children taken away from them. This is really what is happening. It's like the question of surrogacy, the fact that many women are so impoverished that they have to rent their womb, they have to rent their uterus, right, in order to be able to gain some money, right? I mean, Angela Davis was going to be here in a week. She has written a powerful article about that, saying that, you know, renting surrogacy, it's a reenactment of what happened to women during slavery. That you're supposed to raise children, to bring children into the world, but not for yourself. You're supposed to bring them into the world for other people. And that's what surrogacy is really about. And adoption is very similar to that. And the question of the commons, right? The question of the commons. Women are rebuilding commons everywhere. I mean, I was talking before about the struggle that I heard of indigenous women, of women in urban centers, and, you know, women in the field, women from the Amazonia. Women are defending the commons. When they defend the forest from the mining, when they defend the forest or the land or the waters, the rivers, you know, from a mining company or petroleum company, they are defending the commons. They are saying the earth belongs to everyone. It doesn't belong to the mining. It doesn't belong to the petroleum companies. And so it's not true that we cannot go beyond private property. People are going beyond private property. People are fighting and building commons.
Bem, tudo isso aqui fica uma reflexão, uma reflexão para a gente continuar pensando, para a gente continuar lutando. Nosso encontro é muito significativo neste momento, que a gente vê tanta coisa ruim que está sendo plantada e que provavelmente os interessados colherão os frutos o ano que vem, então a gente deve pensar. Mas a gente, eu quero deixar um alerta aqui, que todo mundo tem que ir até onde consegue ir. Eu não aguento mais ver tanta gente falando de tristeza e depressão. Então a gente vai até onde aguenta, depois dá um passinho atrás, depois volta de novo. Eu quero lembrar que vai ter agora um momento de autógrafo desse livro da Silvia, no espaço reservado para isso. E, no mais, muito obrigada por tudo. Que Deus proteja e abençoe a todos.